Church, have a seat. We have a couple more announcements than normal this morning, so if you'll kind of get ready, if you need to take any notes or anything like that. You are aware of the destruction from Hurricane Michael this last week, and what our response is to that is to help the United Methodist Committee on Relief, also known as UMCOR. They will be sending flood buckets. All of their flood buckets from Louisiana will go east over into that direction. And so what we're asking you to consider today is if you'd like to help make a donation towards more flood buckets, if you want to put that in the offering plate today, note it on your check. Just put flood relief, or if you want to put it in one of the envelopes, we will give that as a donation to UMCOR next week to support the work of making more flood buckets. Just to be clear, we're not asking you to bring the flood buckets. We've done that before, but this time we're just asking you to make donations. We're not going to mess with the buckets and all the sponges and all the cleaning supplies that go inside of that. So that's this week. We have one more request for the pumpkin patch. We've been asking for a month and a half, all kinds of different things. This is the last one, and that is to bring candy for the trunk or treat, which is on the 28th. So the trunk or treat is on the 28th from 4 to 6. We're going to have all the trunks out in the parking lot, all the candy. And if you want to help support some of that candy, you can also sign up to be a vehicle in the trunk or treat. That sign-up sheet is out in the Welcome Center, along with t-shirt sales. If you'd like one of these awesome fly pumpkin t-shirts, you can get one. They're $10 for adults and $8 for kids. Those are in the Welcome Center this morning. So that's trunk or treat. That's the pumpkin patch. You guys did an awesome job unloading the pumpkins on Wednesday. How many of y'all were a little bit sore the next day from that work? Y'all did a great, great job. A lot of people out there helping us. We got them unloaded in 2 hours. That was sweet. We have a quilt that Marge Dykus has made. It's beautiful. And so it's up here. She has given this to the work of the pumpkin patch, and there will be a silent auction. The sheets are out in the Welcome Center. We'll be doing this for 3 weeks for the quilt. If you want to come up and look at it later, it's absolutely beautiful. And I believe that is it. It's not it. Lauren says it's not it. All right. Hooray, hooray.
Pastor Allen, the youth would like to let you know how much we appreciate you.
Thank you for all you do for the youth.
Thank you for all you do for our church.
Thank you for being awesome.
Thank you for being there for us.
Thank you for teaching us to be the salt of the earth.
Thank you for inspiring us to be the light of the world.
Thank you, Pastor Allen!
Hey, Pastor Allen. I just want to wish you the very best on this Clergy Appreciation Day. We can't tell you how thankful we are to have you and your family as part of the church. Keep up the great work and your leadership. There's great things ahead of us. God bless you.
All right, Pastor Allen, it's Clergy Appreciation, and we just wanted to say thank you for everything that you do for our church. You're the man. And just for you, we'll probably throw a 90s praise song in the set this week just so we can shout to the Lord or something like that for you. So thank you, Pastor Allen. We love you. Love you, Lord.
All right. Well, thank you all very much. I appreciate all the love and the support. It is an honor to be before you as your pastor. It's also a challenge, and it's a great challenge. And we have a lot of work to do, and we're going to do it. We're up to it. And so thank you for all the cards and gifts and things today. I really appreciate it. Let's invite the children to come up. We've got a special message just for you. So kiddos, come on up down here. Does that mean you're blue today?
Yeah.
Cool. Awesome. All right, kids, come on down. Woohoo! Awesome. Sweetie. Good morning. How are you? I'm Alan. How are you? Good to meet you. All right, guys, have a seat. Good to see you. Pastor Alan doesn't always eat French fries, but sometimes I do. And I was thinking about French fries, so I brought you a invisible French fries. There's no French fries in here, so don't rush me trying to get French fries. But something happens in our family. I want to ask if this happens in your family. When my boys, Beckett or Pax, get French fries, I don't always get French fries, but I want a couple of them. And so during the meal, I'll just kind of reach over and grab some French fries and put them in my mouth real fast. Does your dad or your mom ever do that to y'all when you're eating French fries? Sometimes we say it's the French fry tax. You know, like, well, you're just going to lose some French fries. And why do parents say that? Parents say that because we usually paid for the French fries, right? These are our French fries. Where did this French fry box come from?
McDonald's.
I thought M was for McGrath. Is it not McGrath's? Well, I've got something to talk to about my dad. Okay. All right. So sometimes our parents take a couple of French fries and eat them, and they say, well, I gave you those French fries, and so I can eat some of them, right? And sometimes I know Beckett has gotten good at kind of putting his hand over the French fries because he knows his dad's going to try and sneak a couple. What I'm thinking about today is how God gives us everything that we have. God gives us, well, French fries, but God also gives us our family and our t-shirts and our tennis shoes and our toys and the games that we play. Everything that we have comes from God. And now, I don't think God steals our French fries, but I think God gives us each one of these things, including French fries, so that we would enjoy them, because God loves you very, very much, and God wants you to have everything that you need. And so everything that we have comes from God. So Randy, what are you thinking about? Yes, food and French fries and candy and all kinds of things. Yeah, you do have to eat your food before candy. Yes, it's important. Yes, and French fries too. Okay, so God loves us very much, and God has given us everything. So everything we have, even if it's our French fries that we're having for lunch, everything that we have is from God. And that's important to know, because how we use things is important. If we have a toy, we want to use it well, because it's something that God has given to us. And it's not something that we want to waste, we don't want to break, we don't want to set it in the corner and forget about it. All these things are things that God has given to us. Isn't that wonderful? All right, how many of you are just a little bit hungry now that you've seen this McDonald's? Okay, all right. No breakfast yet. Well, I'll tell you what. Here, you can have this invisible French fry box. All right. Friends, let's pray. Let's bow and pray. and say, Dear Jesus, thank you for loving us. Help us to know that everything we have comes from you. Amen. Amen. Thanks, guys. Y'all are going to go back with the kids' ministry. Parents, if you want your kids to be in here with you for worship, that's okay too. Bye, Serenity. See you, sweetheart. Hi, bud. Today is Food Pantry Sunday. Once a month we do Food Pantry Sunday. We'll put it out there on Facebook and in the newsletter. Today is obviously Corn Day. And so we thank you for those of you that brought some corn. And friends, let's take a moment to pray for our offerings this morning. And God, out of appreciation for the many things that you've placed in our hands and in our lives, we give back to you a portion of what you've given to us. We would ask that we do so not out of an obligation, but we do so out of joy and out of obedience to connect to the things that you're doing here on this earth and in this community. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna.
About something that we tend to think is personal. Allow us to see the deep connections. The work that you've given to us, our money, our finances, our life, our witness, and how it is all one. And then God bless us with encouragement today. Encouragement that even in that part of our life, our business, our work, our taxes, our money. God, we would all see it connected to the work that you've given to us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. If this is not familiar to you at all, it means you're really young. All right. So, King Solomon. King Solomon is young, he's a new king, and God comes to him in a dream. And God says, Solomon, I'm going to give you whatever you ask for, anything you ask for, and I will give it to you. And we love this story because it's a story that we've been sharing and celebrating for generations. We love this idea that someone might come to us one day and say, what do you want? I'll give you anything you want. If it's, what's this show called? Teens, anyone? The show? I Dream of Jeannie. It's okay that you don't know that. It was late 60s. It was a while ago. But a little bit later, we had Aladdin, similar kind of story. We love this story, this image of someone coming in front of us and saying, what do you want? And we dream about it. We think about it. We might want the money of Jeff Bezos. Isn't he the richest man in the world now? Mr. Amazon, right? We may want the musical talent of someone like Paul McCartney. We could just ask for. Sometimes one of the easy go-tos is an island. You want an island somewhere. Some of us may just get really brutally honest and say, I just don't want to work again. I don't want to work another day of my life. And so we look at King Solomon. He's asked this question at the beginning of his time as king. And I think his answer might surprise us. Of all the things that King Solomon could have asked for, here's what he said. He said, I'm young and I'm inexperienced. I know next to nothing. Please give your servant a discerning mind in order to govern your people. Give me a discerning mind. What Solomon is asking for there is wisdom. The very first thing that King Solomon asked for is not all of the money, all of the fame. Some of us know all of the wives, yes? He said, give me wisdom. And God's response is, because you asked for wisdom, then you will get everything that you could have asked for. You'll get everything. Wisdom. And starting with wisdom. The next 3 weeks, we're going to talk about our relationship with money. We're going to talk about our relationship with money. And while we may not have much, I believe that all of us have everything that we need when it comes to money. The question is not how much we have, but the wisdom that we have in using our money and the wisdom that we use when money comes into our hands. And so really over the next 3 weeks we're going to be talking about wisdom and the wisdom that you and I need. Proverbs 4:7 says this. It says, the beginning of wisdom, get wisdom. Isn't that cool? That makes sense, doesn't it? The beginning of wisdom, get understanding before anything else. Just before that in Proverbs 3, it says, happy are those who find wisdom. Her profit is better than silver. So if our role, if our mission here as a church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ, then our use of our money, the use of our money goes straight to the heart of who it is to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. We are not allowed to separate our Sunday spiritual life with our business and our finances and the things that we buy at the grocery store and the things that we buy online and the amount of debt that we pick up. We are not allowed to separate those two. Those are together. And God has wisdom for us, and we need that wisdom.
We need that wisdom if we are retired. We need that wisdom if we're just beginning to enter the work world and we're just years away from getting there. The scriptures again and again talk about money. Scriptures again and again talk about money. There's 500 scriptures about prayer and faith in the Bible. 500, but there's 2,000 scriptures about money and possessions. If you take Jesus' parables, all the stories that Jesus tells, 40% of those parables are about money. And couples, what is the number one thing that we fight about? It's not the toilet seat, friends. It's money. We fight about money. And behind infidelity, the number two reason for divorce in the country is because of money. And so if we think that our vision as a church is to go out and to heal families and to help connect families, to help brokenness, then we're going to be a church that occasionally talks about money and talks about finances and our relationship between the two. It's something that we have to do if we're going to be the church that this community needs. So the next 3 weeks, we're going to look at a sermon from John Wesley from the 1700s. It'll be a little more exciting than that just sounded. And we're going to use a book by James Harnish. He wrote a book called Earn, Save, and Give. And the quote starts, that book starts with a quote from John Wesley that some of us have heard before, but take a second. This is the language here. Having first gained all you can, this is John Wesley talking about money. Having first gained all you can and secondly saved all you can, then give all you can. Maybe that's not how John Wesley put it in there, but earn, save, and give. John Wesley spoke about money quite a bit. He was the Dave Ramsey of the 1700s. I don't know, except you didn't have a kit you could buy from him. So we're going to look at this. Our scripture today comes from 2 Thessalonians. It's Paul talking to his disciples and saying how important it is to work and how important it is to be a person of work and not to be lazy. From 2 Corinthians chapter 3, it says, "You yourselves know how you need to imitate us because we were not undisciplined when we were with you. We didn't eat anyone's food without paying for it. Instead, we worked night and day with effort and hard work so that we would not impose on you. We did this to give you an example to imitate. Not because we didn't have a right to insist on financial support. Even when we were with you, we were giving you this command. If anyone doesn't want to work, they shouldn't eat." Whoa! Wow! Paul is saying if we're going to have a good witness to who we are in Jesus, then we're going to have a good work ethic. We're going to be working. And we're not going to be going out being lazy and trying to ask for free things. But part of their witness as disciples went out and started these new churches was to work and to have this work ethic. So today I want to talk from John Wesley's sermons. I've kind of pulled four keeps. I'm going to say that we're earning for keeps, and there's four keeps that if you're a note taker, you might want to write these down. But John Wesley is setting up some boundaries in his word to go and earn all you can. He's obviously not saying just go out and do whatever you can think of to bring in money. He's not saying go rob a bank, but he's saying go and earn all that you can with discipline. Go out and do the very best that you can with what God has given to you. And so I want us to look at these. The first is keep your health. Keep your health. Now, some of us are in the workplace right now. Some of us in the room have just exited the workplace, but a whole bunch of us are at the very beginning of our career. Many people in here are at the beginning of their career or at the very beginning of their career. They're not sure where that's headed. But John Wesley would say, don't do anything that takes your health. Don't do anything that's going to make you sick. You might add, don't do anything that's going to take all of your energy away so that when you get home for your family, you have nothing left for them. in the work that you do and earning all that you can, keep your health. John Wesley said, neither should we begin or continue in any business which necessarily deprives us of proper seasons of food and sleep. Isn't that nice? We need proper seasons of sleep. I know I need that from time to time. Proverbs 23:4 is going to speak to some of us in here this morning. Those of us that have gone to sleep with the tired head and woken up with it still beating and hurting, okay? There's a word in the scripture for us about working too hard. In Proverbs 23:4, don't wear yourself out trying to get rich. Don't wear yourself out trying to get rich. Be smart enough to stop. We shouldn't be doing anything that's going to take our health. Anything that's going to pull so much energy that we get sick. Keep your health. The second thing, the second boundary that John Wesley sets up for us is keep your soul. Keep your soul. And so anything, we wouldn't want to do anything that's contrary to the law or contrary to God's law. We can do a lot of things illegally to make money. And it's not just robbing banks, but it's also the way we find little ways in our taxes to bring in a few more dollars towards us. It's the way that we can quietly cheat here and there to bring in a little bit more. But integrity is always going to be number one for us. The integrity of the money that's coming in, of earning all you can, doing it in the right way. 1 Timothy 6:10 says, some have wandered away from the faith and have impaled themselves with a lot of pain because they made money their goal. Because they made money their goal. John Wesley would never say that the whole goal is just to go out and make money. That's not our role as a person of faith, is just to go out and make money. There's things to do with that money. But we can just kill ourselves and we can kill our soul if our number one goal is just to bring in more money. Number one is keep your health. Number two, keep your soul. Number three ties into both the first and the second one. Keep your love for your neighbor. Keep your love for your neighbor. Don't do anything in your work that would harm or take advantage of somebody else. Some of the language that we thought of would be like, who's downstream from you? Who's downstream from you in your work? What are they seeing from the work that you're doing? We've got to watch ourselves. David, not like you're thinking right now. That's not what I was thinking, sir. Golly, you guys. You got to watch downstream from you, okay? It was interesting in the 1700s even, John Wesley was sharing specifically about interest and how much interest you would charge someone else. He says, requiring or taking such interest as even the laws of our country forbid. And we know, specifically in a military town, in the place that we're at, these businesses such as payday loans, the places that do predatory lending, that are going to charge you 40, 100, 300% for loans. We know that is something that's hurting our neighbors. It's killing some of our families. I was thankful this week to spend a little time on the internet to learn that the Killeen City Council, not that many years ago, put some ordinances in place that were intended to reduce abusive and predatory lending practices. And so it sounds like there's already some leaders in our community with our eyes on that. But the work that we do, has to benefit God's kingdom and benefit this world and not harm our neighbor, even if it's downstream. Keep your health, keep your soul, keep your love for neighbor. And the fourth is to keep striving to do your best. This is a very Methodist language, that we're on a journey and we're always trying to get better and do better. There's never a point in our faith, there's never a point in our work where we just stop and we say, good, we've made it as far as we need to. We don't do it in baptism. Great, we're baptized. Sit back and just chill. We don't ever do that in our faith. Everything we're doing, we're always trying to strive and do better and do our best. And so this is the encouragement in our work. Don't ever get locked into a place where you're just sitting somewhere for 30 years. We want to be continually learning. We want to be growing. We need to be reading. We need to find things where we're learning more and more each and every day. Keep striving to do your best. Now, I actually did read through the whole sermon from John Wesley. It put me to sleep three times, but then I woke up and kept reading, okay. Towards the end, he talks about this striving to do your best. And he has this phrase, and I wanted to read it to you because it kind of reads like a motivational speech. And I thought maybe some of us need to like copy this and put it next to our bed in the morning if this is what we need, and after coffee, of course. But this is what it says from the sermon in the 1700s. It says, "And whatsoever thy hand findeth to do..." All right, it's already starting out. Awesome. I like it. "Whatever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might. Do it as soon as possible. No delay, no putting off from day to day or from hour to hour. Never leave anything till tomorrow, which can be done today. And do it as well as possible. Do not sleep or yawn over it. Put your whole strength to its work. Spare no pains. Let nothing be done by halves or in a slight and careless manner. Let nothing in your business be left undone if it can be done by labor or patience." And then the band goes through. Dun, da, dun, da, dun, da, dun, da, dun, da, dun. Okay. Do the very best you can with what you have. Teens, if it's, you know, working at the, what was that place we were talking about earlier today? You know, even if it's working here, right? We're going to be working our very best. We're going to do our very best because it's a witness to who we are. It's a witness to the work of our hands. And I promise people are looking and people are watching. Are we being fair? Are we being honest? Are we being fair to our own health and our soul? Are we being fair to our neighbors? And are we always striving to do our best? What a great witness that is to who we believe God has made us to be and what God has placed in our hands. My challenge for you this week, John, can we put those four back up there again, please? My challenge for you this week is to consider these four keeps. Maybe not all four of them at the same time, but maybe just one. What is one of these that you need to focus on this week in the work that you've been given? Is it your health? Is it your soul? Is it something about your business or the way that you're working that is obviously hurting your neighbors? Or is there something you need to do to strive to do your best? Is there something you need to learn? Is there a mentor that you need to connect with and say, I'm getting slow and boring in this one area in my work, and I need to increase that. I need to get better at this. What's that one thing that you need here? That's my challenge for you this week. In earning all that we can, how can we do it even better this week? Now, the sermon doesn't end there because there's two more weeks. It's not just about making money. Next week we're going to talk about saving. We're going to talk a little bit about personal finance. And then the third week it's about giving. And we earn all we can and we save all we can so that we can be joyful givers and we can connect to the things that God's doing on this world. Finally, I want to end with talking a little bit about something you're going to get in the mail, or many of us are going to get in the mail in the next few days. If you're in our directory, if you're a member of the church, over the next few days, you're going to get a letter from the church. And in the letter is going to be an estimate of giving card. And as I say estimate of giving card, everybody go, okay, make that little sound that you need to make. All right. Your finance committee has been working diligently to create a budget for the work of this church that will be balanced. We have a strong desire to have a balanced budget for 2019. That we don't want to present a budget that's way off from income and expenses, which means that all year long we're fretting and we're disappointed and we're upset and all of this. We believe that stewardship is important and the stewardship of what God's put in our hands. So that begins with inviting the congregation to turn in estimate of giving cards. An estimate of giving card is a very simple thing. You just put on there what you estimate that God is asking you to give next year, and you turn it in. It's not a legal contract. We don't have any giant bullies with bats that are going to come to your house and bang on your door throughout the year. We don't do that. This is also not mandatory. Everyone say, not mandatory. Okay, this is not mandatory. This is not something you have to do if you're a member of the church. It is a request, and it's a tool, and it's something that's going to help this congregation as we work through the challenge of our finances as a church. Now, on the card, do we have a picture of the card, John? No? Okay. On the card will be a checkbox, and it's my hope and my prayer that box gets checked a lot, specifically by the families in this room. There's a checkbox that will say, this is the first commitment we've ever made to a church. And it's my hope, that we get a lot of families that make their very first commitment to the church. Does that mean that you're going to automatically start tithing 10% of your income? Probably not. The encouragement, if you've never checked that box, is to find something that you can commit to the work of God here at the church. And make some kind of a commitment that at the end of this, we're going to have a big party. When we get through our financial challenges and our struggles and the mortgage begins to come down, we're going to have a big party. And I want everybody to hold a balloon at that party. I want everyone to be able to say that they played a part, they played a role in moving us through this season of our difficult finances. And I want to encourage you to consider that first gift. So you've got a card. It's come to you in the mail here in the next few days. If you do not get a card and you're either a member or you're active in this church, first, hear my apologies that you didn't get that. We're doing our best in the office to get those addresses all correct and right. But we're going to have extra cards in the Welcome Center the next 2 weeks. And then at the end of that third week, 1, 2, 3, we're going to invite you to get those back into the office. It'll be a huge help and a benefit in us trying to figure out our budget for next year so that we can do this work with joy and not have those fretful finance committees. We're not doing that anymore. All right. If you have any questions about that, you can certainly talk to me. Gordon Dungan is our finance chair. He's one of our ushers here in the service, and you can ask him as well. But that'll be coming out the next few days. So over the next 3 weeks, we're going to talk about earning all you can and saving all you can so that you can give all you can. Friends, we cannot separate the work of our faith and what God wants us to do from our finances. We're not allowed to split those two. They're all together. The way we spend our money, the way we buy things, the way we overspend for things, it's all tied into our faith and our witness and who we believe God is for us. So I want to encourage you in that. I want to see you here the next 2 weeks. I don't want anybody to think, well, we're talking about money, so we're going to take a break. We're going to go camping here for a couple weeks. This is important stuff, and it's important work for the church family to be here to have these conversations. If you're a guest to the church, today is your very first day, I'm so glad that you're here. And I hope that these conversations will be a benefit to you as well. We won't be putting an estimate of giving card in your hand, but we want to encourage you to continue that these conversations be blessings to you as well. All right, friends, let's pray. God, we thank you for the work that you've given to us. A work to go into this community to help heal families and through the power of Jesus Christ to let others know that they are valuable and they are worthy, that we might help them through the struggles that they're dealing with. And God, we know that finances are a huge struggle with our families. So we'd ask that through our work, we would be able to focus in on seeing everything tied together, that the relationships we have, the work that we do, when we get in our car and we drive to work tomorrow morning, that has something to do with our relationship with you and our faith. And God, we'd ask for encouragement as we continue to do that work to the very best that we can. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
We've come to the time in our service for prayer. If you would like to come up during the song to kneel at the altar, you may do so. When the time for the Lord's Prayer comes, the words will be on the screen if you need it there. Let us go to God in prayer.
This morning, each of us have walked in through these doors with different things on our shoulders and different anxieties and concerns. We would ask that as we come in each and every Sunday, we come in knowing that you are our Savior, you are our caretaker, you are the one that comes and wraps your arm around us and walks us through these seasons of life. God, our prayers that we lift up in our bulletin and those that we have close to our heart, we know that you hear them. And God, we bring to you this prayer today with the prayer that you taught to us. Not that we would simply repeat it in church to get us to the next thing, but there is something when the church comes together to pray. And so we say, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. As we forgive. forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Friends, it's been great to be with you this morning. If you've not yet, we would encourage you to take the white registration pad, fill it out, let us know that you're here. If you've got any questions, put them in there, and we'll work to get back to you as soon as we can. It's been an exciting week. There's been lots of orange gourds laying around here, and many of you have been helping with that, so thank you so much. But if you're interested in joining with us at First United Methodist Church, Colleen, we would love a chance to talk to you more about that. If you'll let us know in your registration folder, we'll get back to you and have a conversation and ask, see if we can talk to you about what it means to continue your journey of faith here in this congregation. But it's been good to be with you. Let's stand now and let's sing our final hymn, final song.
You would bear my cross. You would lay down your all that you've done for me.
Of those around you. Go in peace. Amen. We'll see you next week.